I'm so glad now that this is not a boxing ring, you know?
I am too.
Because I would really lose this fight, I think. What do you think when you hear about her doing three matches a year? You did more, didn't you?
Three matches?
Yes.
You see, fighters nowadays only need one or two bouts in order to make millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. When I was fighting 40, 50 years ago, I had to fight 18 times in a year just to pay my bills. So, you know, it's a different game then than it is now, you know. But Cecilia, I congratulate you, and I saw you with your uppercut. I'd have hit you with a left hook.
Dr. Carter, please take us back to 1966. You were actually at a high point in your career then.
And
one night in June. You were arrested.
Well, it really didn't happen in one night in June. You know, I grew up in a segregated society where people with my skin color wasn't allowed to eat in restaurants, wasn't allowed to go to school, wasn't allowed to drink out of water fountains and all that kind of stuff. So I didn't grow up passive. I was very aggressive, you know, when I grew up. And plus the fact that for the first 18 years of my life on this earth, I couldn't talk. I stuttered badly, very, very badly. And people laughed at me because of it, you know. I didn't know, you know, that it was hereditary. My father stuttered, you know. His father stuttered. I didn't know that. Nobody ever told me that. So when people laughed at me, when people made fun of me, the only sound that they hear in reply would be the sound of my fist whistling through the air, you see? So I was very aggressive based upon that. But I was living in Paterson, New Jersey at the time. I was perhaps the most celebrated person living in that city at that time. And I was driving my car on the street, 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And I was stopped by the police at a red light, waiting for the red light to change. And the police surrounded my car and told us to follow the car to them. And we were in a caravan, 5 police cars in my little white car, sandwiched in between them. And they took us to this bar and grill, Lafayette Bar and Grill, where there were 75 to 100 people out in the street. This is when we became aware that something terrible had taken place here. And then they took us to the hospital where one of the surviving victims still survived. And they asked us, just as you saw it in the movie, and they asked us, are these the people who did this? And the man looked at us and said, no, these are not the people.
He was badly wounded.
Beg your pardon?
The man was badly wounded.
Oh, he's shot in the head and the bullet come out of his eye. And, you know, that's badly wounded. And the police were saying, are you sure this is not the guy? Because I've always had a very bad relationship with the Paterson Police Department anyway, you know. So they were wanting to get me out of the way because, like, as I said, I talked, you know what I mean? I was not passive.
How did you react when you were put away like that?
I was furious. How would anybody react? I was absolutely furious. I could not believe this. But you know what? This may seem ironic, but going to prison under the circumstances in which I went to prison as a wrongly convicted person was the best thing that ever happened to me. The very best thing. Because without that, I would have never stopped long enough on my journey to know, to find out who I really am, what I really am. You know what I mean?
It's incredible that you say that. You were a kind of different prisoner.
Oh, I was never a prisoner. That was right. It.
In what sense? Because you were locked away.
It made no difference that they had me chained and shackled and put into a prison in a 5 by 7 foot cell. just because a misinformed jury fed on lies, perjury by jailhouse snitches, just because this misinformed jury found me guilty, did not make me guilty. You understand? And when I went into the prison, I refused to act the part of a guilty person. I refused to wear their clothes. I refused to eat their food. I refused to work their job. I would have refused to breathe the prison's air if I could have done so and yet remained alive. The one thing that I had that could never be compromised was my innocence. You understand? So...
they put you in so-called solitary confinement.
Mm-hmm.
What was that like?
I spent close to 10 of the 20 years that I spent in prison in solitary confinement. And solitary confinement there was literally 6 feet under the ground in total darkness, no sanitary conditions, no running water, no lights, 5 slices of stale bread to eat and a cup of warm water to drink.
But you wore your own clothes.
I was sitting in solitary confinement with a shirt and tie on, you know what I mean? I was free. I was not going to be a prisoner.
Woo.
So you understand what I'm saying?
Great.
Until this suit became shredded rags. You know what I mean? But I was still cool.
It's incredible. Did you ever, during all those years, I mean, you spent 22 years for this.
Yes, right.
Wow.
Did you ever sort of give up?
Listen, I wanted to lay down a whole lot of time, but I couldn't. I couldn't compromise my innocence. You know, everybody said, Reuben, be like other prisoners. Be ordinary so we can come down here and visit you for 90 minutes once a month, you know? Obey the rules and it won't put you in solitary confinement. So even my family wanted me to give up my protestations of innocence, you know? So my family had to go too. They had to get away from me. When I say that that was the best experience that I ever had in my life, I simply mean that in prison I learned the solution to dreaming, the solution to prayer. And this is what young people need to understand. This planet Earth is a paradise. A fantasy island. Whatever you can conceive in your mind and believe, whatever it is, can be achieved. Whatever it is. There are no limitations. We live in a universe of unlimited possibilities. And whatever you can conceive in your mind and believe, you can do it. I mean, my sitting here in Stockholm, Sweden with you today is absolute proof of that. You can do it.
Please welcome Holly Hunter.